sky. Joy of the Father, reach through the darkness, shine across the earth, send the shadows to fly. Tragedies of time were no match for your love. From great heights of glory, you saw my story. God, you entered in and became one of
another thing added to it. Yeah. I've got him. Got her a wheelchair at the airport. They're gonna move her around. So. Yeah.
Good morning.
How you doing? Good to see you, Colin. Yeah. Did you get the help you needed to get your pants?
Yeah, they're in.
Perfect. Awesome. How we doing?
Doing just fine. How
now,
are you doing?
Now, if we get $10,000, can we put some hair back on your head?
Yeah. You know, the other day when you was up there saying you were going to be shaved, I was going to do this. You know?
Yeah.
I was thinking that money we got in that jar.
Yeah.
All my name's all on all that paperwork, so I'll go get it.
Okay.
I'm going to put in that $3,000 into the lottery moon.
Good morning. We're glad to see you. Would you stand as we worship the Lord? Light of the world, treasure of heaven, brilliant like the stars in the wintry sky, joy of the Father, reach through the darkness, shine across the earth, send the shadows to flight. Light of the world, from the beginning, the tragedies of time were no match for your love. Thank you.
son is given, a son is given. For unto us a child is born, a son is given, a son is given. The Messiah, all to see him high lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. For unto us a child is born, a son is given, a son is given. For unto us a child is born, a son is given, a son is given. The Messiah, oh, to see him high lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. You are high lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy. A child is born. Holy, holy, holy. For unto us a child is born. He's holy, holy, holy. For unto us a child is born. He's so holy, holy, holy. For unto us a child is born.
He loved us and wanted to be close to us.
Everything was how it was supposed to be.
But we fell.
We sinned.
And no matter how hard we tried, we couldn't make it right.
But that didn't stop him.
He reached down to us.
He sent his son.
As the perfect sacrifice to save us.
One sacred effort to redeem mankind.
We are part of this effort.
Going across the world.
To every tribe.
Every nation.
No matter the cost.
When we signed on the dotted line and said we want to follow Jesus, that means we left everything behind. And that he is now my hopes and my dreams.
We share the gospel, plant churches, and make disciples.
Because we believe the gospel can transform lives and communities.
We go to the people who have yet to hear.
Sharing the story with them so that they can tell others.
Multiplying the story of God's grace among all people.
One sacred effort.
It's just wonderful how we as a body of Christ can come united in one effort to carry the Great Commission throughout the world.
When Jesus tells his disciples to be his witnesses, he's not giving a mandate just for that period and that time. He's giving a mandate to the church for all time.
As the body of Christ, we're like an orchestra, or like a band. Each member is so vital, is so important for making beautiful music.
For over a century, churches like yours, working together, have sent people around the world through IMB to share God's love with those who have never heard.
And if we sent them out alone, then they would not make it because they wouldn't be able to stand. But if we send them out as the church, then they can stand against the world.
100% of your gifts go to helping send out your missionaries to tell the story.
Too many times we get so interested in building our own kingdoms, but we've got to look at the bigger picture. Again, this is one sacred effort, all of us coming together to impact the world. And we've got to get behind our workers and support them. Let's make world missions a priority through our giving to the Light of Moon Christmas offerings so we can support these efforts that are being made all across the world.
So we come together as one body, as one sacred calling to God to touch this world. Jesus will smile on us and we'll change this world for him.
We are all part of one sacred effort to see people
across the world
proclaiming together
at the top of their lungs
that Jesus Christ is Lord.
Well, good morning, everybody. It's so good to see you here today at Canyons Church. And you know, as I look at this band and orchestra that's behind me, and you see how they work together, just like she talked about, and in the same way that they work together to make beautiful music, we, the church, come together. We all do our part in reaching the nations with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so that's what the Lottie Moon Christmas offering is all about. It's about us all doing our part together so that we can have these missionaries supported the way they need to be as they work overseas. And so I want to challenge you to give, if you haven't already, prayerfully give and give sacrificially your biggest gift this Christmas, maybe even, to missions so that people can know the good news. I mean, you look around at how God has blessed us, and yet there are people around the world who have not heard the name of Jesus. There's people who do not have the scriptures in their language, and we are able to come and worship in this place. Hey, God has given us, and much is expected. And so as we give together, he will accomplish it for his glory. One thing real fast. If we hit 4,000, which is the pastor's challenge, you guys know what happens, right? And Justin sings. Okay, so I'm going to lose my hair. Justin's going to sing. We've already passed our goal of 2020, but we've not yet reached the goal of the pastor's challenge. But I heard that there is somebody here that if we can hit 5,000, we'll put hair back on their head. And I'm not going to call them by name. I'm just going to call them Ton Rompson, okay? All right. But anyhow, thank you for being here this morning. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, what a joy it is to be in your house. We're blessed beyond measure. Lord, we're able to know you and to know your gospel. And you have given us, as stewards of this gospel, the responsibility to be your ambassadors, to be ministers of reconciliation, to be missionaries, to take the gospel to the ends of the earth and to make disciples of all nations. Lord, may we all do our part. May we all sacrificially give. May we all pray. May we all, yes, even go and share the good news across the street, across this state, across this land, and to the ends of the earth. For your glory, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I don't know about you, but I remember a time when the welcome at church was, all right, take a moment to say hello to the people around you. I miss those days. I can't ask you to do it today. But how about you take a moment, if you can, try to find out the name of someone you don't know from your seat. Try to do that right now. Try to figure out the name of someone you don't know. All right. Awesome. Okay. Now, whoever you learn their name, guess what you get to do after service today? You get to go and have a conversation with that person because you just learned their name, all right? If you're visiting, welcome home to Canyons. We want this to be your church body home. Join us in the work of praising the Lord Jesus together. There is a contact card in front of you. If you're a visitor, please fill that out, turn it in on your way out, and we have a gift for you as well. All right, let's stand together and continue in worship.
us adore, the one who came for us. Glory in the highest, praise the name of Jesus, our King.
This is the story of a ragtag bunch of church members who set out to perform a Christmas play, and the director, who tried his hardest to just keep it all together. The glory of Christmas.
There's a little bit of controversy over my choice to cast Tony as the wise man in our church nativity play, because, well, Tony can sometimes be...
Yep, that's some good birch.
Birch? Why would they use birch? It's not even indigenous to Israel.
Tony's just a little bit of a know-it-all.
Dedication not even cross your mind?
That's probably birch.
Potato salad is of German origin, brought over here by European settlers. You know, fascinating point. The carb load on that is 37 grams. Great for marathon runners.
There's no doubt that Tony knows a lot of useless facts. But when he doesn't know something...
Now, of all the wise men's gifts, myrrh was the most profound. He's used to prepare a body for burial.
What does real myrrh smell like?
I imagine it has like a lush floral scent.
Nah, it's woodsy. Warm, aromatic, musky.
Oh, my mom leads the essential oils small group.
But there's a certain something about Tony. Something that he doesn't even see about himself.
Put your shoulder into it so it doesn't strip the head.
That's like...
Hey, well done. That's good. Good job.
Tony has the kind of heart that understands where the real treasures are. What they are, who they are. And he understands the King of Kings came first as the lowly servant.
This baby, this beautiful gift, this the glory of God, the glory of Christmas, who would eventually sacrifice himself for us. For me, well, let's just say, with that kind of knowledge, you can never approach the manger quite the same way again.
That's why he's the wise man.
Well, the story is told, does that sound familiar? Of a small southern town where a nativity scene showed great skill and talent in its construction. One small feature, though, bothered a man who was driving through on a trip. You see, the three wise men were wearing firemen's helmets. Totally unable to come up with a reason or explanation, he left the nativity scene and stopped at a quick stop on the edge of town. The visitor asked the man behind the counter about the helmets. The man exploded into a rage, yelling at the man.
You Yankees never do read the Bible.
The man assured him that he certainly did read the Bible, but simply couldn't recall anything about firemen in the Bible. The man whipped out his Bible from behind the counter and ruffled through some pages, and finally jabbed his finger at a passage, sticking it in the man's face. He said,
"See right here, it says the wise men came from afar."
I had to get Jason to do it because I knew I wouldn't get the accent right. Thank you.
I'm just here to help.
That's right.
Yeah.
So today is the Sunday before Christmas, and for the last few weeks, we have done several character studies from the Christmas story. We've studied Mary, we've studied Joseph, and the shepherds. Today is our last full character study before Christmas and our Christmas Eve service, and today we're going to look at the wise men. So these men, they surprise us at every turn, and by looking at their example, we're going to prepare our hearts and our minds as we draw close to Christmas and remembering the reason for the season. So if you'll turn with me in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 2. Matthew chapter 2, we're going to read verses 1 through 12. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of King Herod, wise men from the east arrived in Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he who has been born King of the Jews? For we saw his star at its rising and have come to worship him." When King Herod heard this, he was deeply disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. So he assembled all the chief priests and scribes of the people and asked them whether Christ would be born. "In Bethlehem of Judea," they told him, "because this is what was written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, because out of you will come a ruler who will shepherd my people, Israel.'" Then Herod secretly summoned the wise men and asked them the exact time the star appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search carefully for the child. When you find him, report back to me so that I too can go and worship him." After hearing the king, they went on their way. And there it was, the star they had seen at its rising. It led them until it came and stopped above the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overwhelmed with joy. Entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and falling to their knees, they worshiped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And being warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their own country by another route.
As we pick up this morning and take a look at this text, I want us to make three observations that I believe will stand out to you in Scripture. Notice, first of all, what the wise men did. The wise men saw. They saw. Now, we've already seen that God made his birth announcement. We talked about that last week. He made the announcement of his son to the simple, lowly shepherds. He did not make the birth announcement in the temple or in a synagogue. He did not make it to the high priest. Instead, he made it out in a field to those stinky shepherds who were keeping watch over the flock by night. But then in Matthew 2, we find that God not only led the shepherds to Jesus, but he also led the wise men to come as well. And you know, that's what God does. God is a missionary God. God is the one who sent his son. He took action so that we might be reconciled and saved. And so verse 1 says this: "After Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of King Herod, wise men from the east arrived in Jerusalem." Now notice that very first phrase there. It says that this event occurred after Jesus was born. Now I know that oftentimes when we have our nativity scenes, we've got the shepherds and we've got the wise men and they're all in there together. It's more likely that a good bit of time has passed to this point, and maybe even as much as 2 years have passed since Jesus was born. So when the wise men arrive, Jesus is not laying in that feeding trough still. He's grown a little bit. He's not a newborn baby. But we find that Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, which is known, again, as the city of David. If you weren't with us last week, I'll just say a quick word about that. Bethlehem is the city where David was born. It's the hillside surrounding Bethlehem where he would have shepherded as a young shepherd boy. It's the place where Saul anointed him as the new king. And so this is called the city of David. In Bethlehem, the son of David, the Messiah, the King of Kings, the chief shepherd, was born. And it says here that this took place in the days of King Herod. Now, King Herod was a madman. I'm going to let Justin hit on that in just a moment. But he was a crazy guy. And so the wise men show up there before Herod. And it says in verse 1, the wise men from the east arrived in Jerusalem. How many of you are not originally from Utah or Salt Lake City? Quite a few. You know, if you're like me when you showed up, you had to get used to the grid system a little bit, right? I mean, it makes sense now, but I remember I showed up and somebody said, hey, we're gonna meet in the southwest corner of the northeast parking lot. Who talks like that? I don't know. Or my GPS would say, go north on 1300 east, or go east on 9000 south. And then people would call it 90th, not 9000. And so I was just confused the whole time when I first moved here. But in comparison, this is pretty simple. The wise men came from the east to Jerusalem. So if they were coming to the east, they were traveling in which direction? West, right? Therefore, the star that they were looking at would have been in the western sky, right? Are we together so far? Okay. Who were these so-called wise men? Who were they? Well, I know who they weren't. They weren't BYU graduates. They weren't graduates of Clemson or Florida either, just FYI. But commentators do suggest that their descendants may very well have been the founders of the University of Georgia. So there you go. The Greek word here, magoi, is translated as wise men in the CSB. The NIV just simply leaves it as magi. But originally, this word would be referring to those people, a class of Persian wise men who were interpreters of special signs, astrologers. They even called magicians by this name. And so these men obviously would have been somewhat familiar or very familiar with the heavens, with the stars. And so, peeking ahead to verse 2, we should not be surprised to note that they saw a star at its rising. So they saw it. They saw the star. And then in verse number 7, Herod actually asked the exact time that the star appeared. And they knew that because they knew about stars. And so they're watching and they see this unusual star, and they begin to figure out what it may have meant. So here they are in an area that would be ancient Babylon, Persia, that area. And I got to thinking and looking closer at this, and can you think of anybody from the Old Testament, a prophet, who may have been in that region not too long before this? How about Daniel? Remember Daniel, a great person of influence? Daniel even prophesied. Daniel prophesied that there would be the anointed one in Daniel 9. He even prophesied that the anointed one would be cut off. Could it be that Daniel and then those other Jewish people who were left behind who did not return to Jerusalem had influenced these wise men to the point that they had some knowledge of Hebrew scriptures, enough to be able to connect the dots between this supernatural star and this king that was to be born? So the bottom line is that these men likely knew not only about stars, but had some knowledge about Hebrew scriptures. And so they arrive in Jerusalem. They arrive in the holy city, the home of the temple, the place of sacrifice. They may have been following a star, but let me ask you this question. Was it a star that they were really looking for? Now, they were following a star, but they were looking for a king. In verse 2, they ask this question, where is he who has been born king of the Jews? So they're following this star, but they were really seeking Jesus. Now, we've pointed out they may have had access to the Hebrew scriptures. Listen to this one. Numbers 24:17 says, I see him, but not now. I perceive him, but not near. A star will come from Jacob, and a scepter will arise from Israel. Could it be that they knew what that passage said in the Old Testament? Could it be that God spoke to them directly, as he did through angels with Joseph and Mary or Zechariah. We don't really know that because it doesn't say here, but we do see that a few verses later, they are warned not to go back to Herod, but to go home by another route. Now, the star that they were following, what was that star? Well, let me hit this one first. How many wise men were there? Who wants to guess at that? How many does tradition say that there were? Three. Why does tradition say there were three? Three gifts that were brought. So then we have three at the manger scene with their gold, frankincense, and myrrh. But we really don't know. All we know is that it's wise men, plural. So it wasn't one. It was men. It could have been two. Could have been three. Could have been a whole lot. We really don't know. And they were following this star, verse 2, that they saw at its rising, and they've come to worship him. So the wise men saw this star. And many people will point to celestial happenings in history and the way things can line up, and maybe that was the star that led them. For example, have you heard of the news? Tomorrow night, right? The Christmas star. Look in the southwest sky about 45 minutes after sunset, I think is how it goes. Correct me if I'm wrong. But look, and what's going to happen? Jupiter and Saturn are going to come so close together that they become one bright light. And they're calling it the Christmas star. Could it have been something like that that happened? Maybe. It could have been. The star is behaving unusually. It seems to be moving and stopping and doing different things. So I don't know. Here's what I do know. God was supernaturally using that star. Whether it was a star or whether it was Comet or Cupid or Donner or, it is Christmas. Whatever it was, God was using it supernaturally to lead them to come and see Jesus. And by the way, the God who created everything can do the supernatural. So they were brought there, and Matthew 2:9 says, it was there, the star they had seen at its rising. It led them until it came and stopped above the place where the child was. They had come to worship him. And so they saw the star, but even more importantly, they saw him. And verse 10 adds that they were overwhelmed with joy. And verse 11 says, entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother. You know, this is a story not about a miraculous star. This is a story about a miraculous king who came to earth. You know, when you look at the feeding of the 5,000, the point is not how good the food was. The point is that Jesus is king, and Jesus performed miracles. Jesus is God in the flesh. And that's what the focus is here too, not the star. And so the wise men came and they saw him, and seeing him, they bowed and they worshiped him. And so God wants to do in our lives. He wants us to come and see and to know him and to worship him. Do you remember when you trusted Jesus as your Savior? If you're here today and you've trusted him, there's a little hymn that goes like this. What a wonderful change in my life has been wrought since Jesus came into my heart. I have light in my soul for which long I had sought since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Floods of joy o'er my soul, help me, like the sea billows roll since Jesus came into my heart. And I'm going to tell you, wise men still bow to Jesus, and wise women do too. We bow before the King of Kings. Have you seen him? Do you know him? Pastor.
The wise men worshiped the king. And just reviewing a little bit of what Jason said, the wise men were aware of the meaning of the star, but were unsure exactly where to go. To find the King of the Jews, it was logical to go to Jerusalem. And it also seems that, as Jason said, the star stood still after rising, and then in verse 9 and 10, it began to move, and it led them to Bethlehem once they were done with Herod. Before then, the star was just simply over Israel from their perspective. It's interesting to me to consider this. On one side, you have the wise men. They knew about the birth of the King of the Jews, and in verse 2, we see that they knew that he was worthy to be worshipped. yet they didn't know where exactly he was to be born. And to me, that indicates that they didn't have access to all of Hebrew scripture, particularly of Micah, where the prophecy is found. So, but even though they didn't have access to all of the Hebrew scriptures, they did have access to some. They knew about the birth. They knew he was worthy to be worshipped. That's on one side. Now, on the other side, we have the Jews. Okay, this is King Herod, the chief priests, and the scribes. And guess what? They have access to all of the Hebrew scriptures. Yet, they didn't know that he was born. Or at least they're taken by surprise. They knew where he was going to be born, in Bethlehem, but they totally missed something, or maybe even ignored. They missed that this child was worthy of worship. You know, when they answer the wise men, the religious leaders quote Micah 5:2, but they leave out a key component of the verse, and I'm willing to bet that most of us leave out a key component of this verse. I want to turn there with you, Micah 5, verse 2. We'll have it up on the screen if you want to look there. So Micah 5:2 says, Bethlehem Ephrathah, you are small among the clans of Judah. One will come from you to be ruler over Israel for me. And that's where the quote ends, right? That's where most of us end. But look at the rest of verse 2. His origin, that is the Messiah's origin, is from antiquity, from ancient times. You see, Jesus' origin was not that stable. Jesus' origin wasn't Bethlehem. It wasn't the place where he grew up in Galilee. In fact, Jesus' origin is from antiquity or from prehistoric times. From even before time, his origin is from eternity. I want to point out the word antiquity here is the same word used in Deuteronomy 33, verse 27, which says, the eternal God is your dwelling place. It doesn't say the antiquity God. The word conveys the concept of beyond time. The eternal God is your dwelling place. And in Habakkuk chapter 1, verse 12, it uses the word as well, and it reads, are you not from everlasting, O Lord, my God, my Holy One? Again, it does not say, are you not from antiquity? The concept is there, from everlasting, from eternity. You see, Messiah, his origin is from eternity. And you know, it seems that the religious leaders missed this important truth. And I don't want to be too harsh on them because hindsight is 20/20. But they really don't have any excuse. They were experts at the Hebrew scriptures. They knew scriptures better than I will ever know scripture. And yet they missed just the last part of that verse. These religious leaders were disturbed right along with King Herod, as we see in verse 3. You know, it's ironic to me that the Gentile astrologers, the magicians, pagans, if you will, they knew to worship the Christ child. But Jesus' own people rejected him. John chapter 1 tells us, he came to his own, but his own people rejected him. But the wise men, they knew that the king that they sought was worthy of worship. At the end of our passage today, we see that the wise men are told to avoid Herod. And just after that, if you were to go further in chapter 2, we see that Joseph is told to take Jesus to Egypt. In Herod, I think we see just how ugly human pride can get. You see, Herod was a half-Jewish convert that only played the part in order to stay in charge of the Jews. He was known to kill anyone around him who he suspected of challenging him, even his wives and children. Caesar Augustus even said that he would rather be Herod's pig than his son, which is a play on word in the Greek. They're very close to each other, pig and son. You see, Herod's reign was challenged by the visit of the wise men. You look at verse 3 for me. We see that Herod and all of Jerusalem, I don't think that every person in Jerusalem was deeply disturbed. I think this probably references verse 4, the religious leaders, the scribes. But it says that Herod and all of Jerusalem were deeply disturbed. Now, this word carries the idea of terror, and it's going to be used later on in Matthew to describe the disciples when they saw Jesus walking on the water and thought he was a ghost. They were terrified. It's the same word used to describe Herod here. Just like the disciples, Herod was terrified, and guess what his response was? He's going to eliminate the threat. So Herod attempts to manipulate the wise men. He claims he wants to worship Messiah too, asking them to report where they find the Messiah. However, as we know, Herod was plotting to kill Jesus. You know, as Jason and I were preparing this message, Jason framed the person of Herod very well. This is what Jason said. He said, "Kings don't easily bow down to other kings. Kings don't easily bow down to other kings." You see, Herod isn't wanting to worship the king. He's wanting to kill the king in order to remain the king. Herod refused to accept that Jesus is the true king. And he certainly didn't understand that Jesus isn't just the king of the Jews. Jesus is the king of kings. And guess what? Herod's going to bow before him. I want you to turn with me in your Bibles to Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2, and we're going to start in verse 5. Philippians chapter 2, verse 5. This is what it says. "Adopt the same attitude as that of Christ Jesus, who, existing in the form of God, did not consider equality with God as something to be exploited. Instead, he emptied himself by assuming the form of a servant, taking on the likeness of humanity. And when he had come as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even to death on a cross. For this reason, God highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord, to the glory of God the Father." Amen.
Amen.
Amen. You see, Herod refused to bow, but we know that one day Herod's going to bow before King Jesus. All will bow before him, and all will confess that he is Lord. So let me ask you, whose example will you follow today? Will you be like Herod and resist and fight against the one true King of Kings? Will you be like Herod, ruling over your own domain, acting like a king? Are you a fake king who won't easily bow before other kings? Or will you be like the wise men who seek Jesus and willingly, joyfully bow before him? Because here's the reality. You will bow before Jesus. You'll either do it willingly, or you will be forced to bow. And I'm telling you, today is the day to choose to bow willingly. And let me tell you something. Jesus is worthy of your worship. He's no tyrant king like Herod. He's no fake puppet king. He is the most gracious, merciful, and loving king. He is also the most just, righteous, and powerful king. And just in case you think it sounds a bit harsh to force people to bow, I want you to know this. I'm convinced of this. No person in all of history in that moment will doubt that he is due worship and that we are all to bow to him. No one will doubt it. So I want to encourage you today, be like the wise men. If you're hearing this message today, perhaps the Lord is showing you your own sort of star. And he's leading you to Jesus. I want you to seek him. Approach him today and bow before the king. because he is the only good and perfect king worthy of all worship and honor and praise and glory. Now, if you're sitting here and Jesus is already your king, I want you to consider something. How do you worship him? Have you ever physically fallen to your knees in worship? Now, that may sound awkward or embarrassing, but I want you to consider the wise men, the prestigious, learned wise men.
By the way, learned people use words like prestigious right here.
I ought to get on my knees, what I should do. Consider them, okay? You've got these well-educated, perhaps they were clothed in rich fabric based off the gifts that they've brought to Jesus. When they see a child, what do? They disregard any expensive clothing that they're wearing. They fall to their knees and they worship Jesus. So what is your response? What is your response? You see, to the wise men, Jesus was just a toddler, right? They knew he was the king of the Jews and that he was worthy of worship, but think about who Jesus is to us. He is the crucified, resurrected, and ascended Lord. Will you bow before King Jesus? Let me tell you, he is worthy of your worship.
So we've seen that the wise men saw. They saw the star, they saw the child, they worshiped. And flowing out of that worship, we see that the wise men gave. Maybe you've noticed that I say this a lot because I really want to teach this, and I believe this is true of biblically, that our giving is worship, that all that we do for his glory is worship. So it's not like worship is just when we sing. No, it's whatever we do for his glory. And so we give tithes and offerings, we give like we're doing to the missions, but we also give of ourselves, and we use the gifts that God has given us to worship him. Well, the wise men, upon seeing Jesus, fell to their knees, and they worshiped him. They knew intuitively that there was something different about this baby. We've already said maybe they had access to Daniel's prophecy and the anointed one being cut off. And so whatever they knew this is the king. This child is worthy of worship. And so they opened up their treasures and they presented him with gifts of gold and frankincense and myrrh. Now there's no doubt that these gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh were fitting for royalty. No doubt about that. There's no doubt that they were giving these as an act of worship. There's no doubt that these gifts, practically speaking, will come in handy when they have to flee into Egypt. These gifts will come in handy. But these gifts also have deep meaning. By bringing the gold, the wise men were acknowledging the kingship of Jesus. It was very common for people to bring gifts on royal visits, and one example of that was when Queen Sheba came to visit King Solomon, and she brought lots of what? Of gold. But they didn't just bring gold, they also brought to Jesus frankincense. And in doing so, the wise men were not only acknowledging Jesus' kingship, but also that he is God, and it emphasizes his priestly role. Frankincense, when burned, created a strong and beautiful aroma. It was like using an essential oils diffuser for your house. Who does that? Two of you were willing to raise your hand. And so, and they have lots of purposes, even medicinally, but this could not be purchased at Walmart or even on Amazon. It was way too expensive. The burning of frankincense, therefore, was reserved for the worship of deity, of God. In the temple itself, they burned incense on the altar, and it was frankincense that they would burn. Exodus 30:34 points to using frankincense as part of the incense for sacrifices. And so in this way, frankincense is pointing towards the great high priest that we have in Jesus Christ, as identified in Hebrews 4:14-16. But they didn't just bring gold, they didn't just bring frankincense, but they also brought myrrh. And so not only is this a king, and not only is he God and has this high priestly role, but he is actually a king that is born to die. Because the myrrh was used, as we heard in the video a few moments ago, for anointing oil and embalming. And so the wise men were bringing to Jesus literally a gift that was used as a burial spice. The wise men seemed to understand some things intuitively, that Jesus was king, that he was unique, he was God's son, and that he had come to die a very unique death for the sins of the world. We don't know exactly, but we know this, they knew to worship, they knew to bow. By the way, time out, wise men still come bearing gifts. It's about this time every year that I try to look the men right in the eyes and say, it is the Sunday before Christmas. If you have not acted yet and you're married, wise men still come bearing gifts, okay? You just need to understand that. I'm trying to help you right now. The wise men not only worship through the giving of gifts, but they also worship through obedience. Being warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, verse 12, they returned to their own country by another route. They didn't hesitate in their obedience to God. You know, a lot of times God will ask us to do A, and we'll say, well, God, I'll do B, C, and D. But he's asking us to do A. Obedience is better, isn't it? Romans 12, 1 and 2, present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true worship. Do not be conformed to this age, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind so that you may discern what is the good, pleasing, perfect will of God. The star said, come and see. The angel to the shepherds said, come and see. And the gospel that is extended to anyone who will hear is an invitation to come and see, and having seen him, to come to know him, and coming to know him, being reconciled with God, and having salvation, and being saved by the grace of God, now I can walk with him and present myself, my body, everything that I am, to him as a living sacrifice, which is my reasonable form of worship. This baby, this beautiful gift, this glory of Christmas, they said in the video, with that kind of knowledge, you can't look at the manger the same way ever again. Let me close with this thought. July 2011, there was a man and his wife who were in Yellowstone National Park, and the man was brutally attacked and killed by a mama grizzly bear. Can you guess why the bear killed him? Well, she perceived that he was a threat to her cubs. He wasn't, but she perceived that he was, and so nature kicked in, and she defended her cubs, and she attacked that man. Did you know that there is a proverb that says, let a bear robbed of her cubs, you'd rather a bear robbed of her cubs meet a man rather than to meet a fool in his folly? In other words, you're better off to go up against the bear than you are against a fool. Did you know the world is full of them? And they're running as fast as they can in the wrong direction, living it up in this world, doing whatever they want, pretending that they are living the life, but they're going 100 miles per hour the wrong way. And they're just deceiving others along the way. But the wise man, the wise woman, is the one who sees that Jesus is king, and seeing that Jesus is king, invites him to be the king of their life, thereby being forgiven of sin and having everlasting life. Are you wise today? Do you know that you know him? Because Christmas doesn't mean a thing to you if you don't know the King of Christmas, Jesus himself. Justin.
We want you to see the Lord Jesus today. We want you to bow before him and offer him all that you have and to obey him. As Pastor Jason asked, Do you know him? He's the king. Will you bow before him? He's worthy of your worship. Will you give yourself to him in obedience? He is a good master. We're about to have a time of invitation. During this time, if you do not know King Jesus, come forward. Come forward to the altar. Talk to Jason or I. Come to know Jesus today. For everyone else, bow before him in your heart, literally, at your seat. Come forward if you want. Bow before King Jesus today. Worship him. Do as the wise men did.
Lord, I pray that you would move in this time of invitation. Lord, have your will and way. And Lord, just as we have prayed and just as we have given and just as we have preached your word, now the way we respond to your word in obedience is worship as well. So whatever you're saying to us, Lord, may we agree with you. May we turn from our ways, our wicked ways, to you. And Lord, we pray that you would use us mightily to bring you glory. In Jesus' name. Stand and sing, if you will.
You are the Word at the beginning, one with God, the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name.
my own. Thank you for being here to worship with us. I do want to say it's good to see Jaden and Adam, both home serving our country, and we're so thankful for you. Go give them a fist bump or an elbow bump or something. We're so glad to have them here with us. And Adam's dad, Dave Simon, is our deacon of the week, and so he's going to close us out with prayer. Don't forget the Christmas Eve service. It's on Christmas Eve at 4:30 and 6:30, okay? So be sure and see Pastor Justin if you haven't gotten tickets yet. We're trying to do the tickets so we know how many's coming to each service. So he is your man, okay? Brother Dave?
Thank you, Jason. Lord, we thank you for this blessed day. We thank you for this church and for these pastors who have given us the message of Christmas and of your son. Just be with us.